Good morning and welcome to St. Paul. It's a blessing to be in worship with you, even if we're not in the same place, but at the same time sharing God's word and growing in it together. Today is the last Sunday of the church year. The calendar year operates a little differently, but we are celebrating Christ the King Sunday, remembering the day that our Lord will at last come again and take us to be with himself in heaven. Next Sunday will be the first Sunday in Advent, and that begins then the whole cycle of remembering the people of God waiting for the Savior to come and Jesus' birth and his life. We look forward to going through Jesus' life with you again next week. May God bless your worship with us. Amen. We make our beginning in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. O come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker. For he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture and the sheep of his hand. We confess our sins. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let us then confess our sins to God our Father. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has heard your confession. He has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake he forgives you for all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore forgive you for all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you.
Let's pray. Eternal God, merciful Father, you have appointed your Son as judge of the living and the dead. Enable us to wait for the day of his return with our eyes fixed on the kingdom prepared for your own from the foundation of the world. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
The Old Testament reading is from Ezekiel chapter 34. For thus says the Lord God, behold, I myself will search for my sheep and will seek them out. As a shepherd seeks out his flock when he is among his sheep that have been scattered, so will I seek out my sheep, and I will rescue them from all places where they have been scattered on a day of clouds and thick darkness. And I will bring them out from the peoples and gather them from the countries and will bring them into their own land. And I will feed them on the mountains of Israel, by the ravines, and in all the inhabited places of the country. I will feed them with good pasture, and on the mountain heights of Israel shall be their grazing land. There they shall lie down in good grazing land, and on rich pasture they shall feed on the mountains of Israel. I myself will be the shepherd of my sheep, and I myself will make them lie down, declares the Lord God. I will seek the lost, and I will bring back the strayed, and I will bind up the injured, and I will strengthen the weak, and the fat and the strong I will destroy. I will feed them in justice. Therefore, thus says the Lord God to them, behold, I myself will judge between the fat sheep and the lean sheep. Because you push with side and shoulder, and thrust at all the weak with your horns till you have scattered them abroad, I will rescue my flock. They shall no longer be a prey. I will judge between sheep and sheep, and I will set up over them one shepherd, my servant David, and he shall feed them. He shall feed them and be their shepherd. And I, the Lord, will be their God, and my servant David shall be prince among them. I am the Lord, I have spoken. This is the word of the Lord.
The epistle lesson from the 15th chapter of 1 Corinthians. But in fact, Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. For as by a man came death, by a man has come also the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, so also in Christ shall all be made alive, but each in his own order. Christ the first fruits, then at his coming those who belong to Christ. Then comes the end, when he delivers the kingdom to God the Father after destroying every rule and every authority and power. For he must reign until he has put all his enemies under his feet. The last enemy to be destroyed is death, for God has put all things in subjection under his feet. But when it says all things are put in subjection, it is plain that he is accepted who put all things in subjection under him. When all things are subjected to him, then the Son himself will also be subjected to him who puts all things in subjection under him, that God may be all in all. This is the word of the Lord.
The Holy Gospel, recorded for us by St. Matthew in his 25th chapter, beginning at verse 31. Jesus said, when the Son of Man comes in his glory, and all the angels with him, then he will sit on his glorious throne. Before him will be gathered all the nations, and he will separate people one from another, as a shepherd separates the sheep and the goats. And he will place the sheep on his right, but the goats on his left. Then the king will say to those on his right, come, you who are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. I was naked, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you visited me. I was in prison, and you came to me. Then the righteous will answer him, saying, Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you drink? And when did we see you a stranger and welcome you, or naked and clothe you? When did we see you sick or in prison and visit you? And the king will answer them, truly I say to you, as you did it to one of the least of these brothers of mine, you did it to me. Then he will say to those on his left, depart from me, you cursed, into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me no food. I was thirsty, and you gave me no drink. I was a stranger, and you did not welcome me, naked, and you did not clothe me, sick and in prison, and you did not visit me. Then they also will answer, saying, Lord, when did we see you hungry or thirsty or stranger or naked or sick or in prison and did not minister to you? Then he will answer them, saying, truly I say to you, as you did not do it to the one of the least of these, you did not do it to me. And these will go away into eternal punishment, but the righteous into eternal life. This is the gospel of our Lord.
Grace, mercy, and peace be to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. This year seems different. And I don't only mean that in a tongue-in-cheek way. I actually mean the events of this year, pandemic, national racial tension, an election season, unemployment, relentless natural disasters, personal stress, social and physical distance from others. These all have had holistic implications on our lives. It has impacted our whole being, physically, mentally, emotionally, and spiritually. Physically, we are often getting to the end of the day feeling weak and drained. Psychiatrists for months have been talking about the mental health crisis that we're in. Emotionally, you may feel all over the place from one minute to the next. A card from a friend or a personal interaction or a home project finished gives you joy, while then the next moment you hear about the disappointing news of more gathering restrictions and worsening case numbers and rising death tolls. And spiritually, this one's tricky, because I'm not sure how all of you are spiritually, as a whole, the plural you. I know individually, many of you have grown deeper in your faith over this year, 2020. While I know some of you are feeling a sense of spiritual isolation in the midst of physical isolation. And I can speak for myself when I say that this year seems different in the way that I've approached the end of the church year, coming back to now this last Sunday in the church year. We've been looking in the month of November at a bunch of texts, Old Testament and New Testament, that talk about the end times and Jesus coming in his kingdom, his judgment, and the salvation that he brings. And all of these seem to have a deeper meaning this year. Maybe it's because of the facade of my own control of my life that is being broken down. Maybe it's because we see the ravages of sin around us all too clearly. Maybe it's because we're being honest with ourselves about what is truly important and needful and lasting and true. We know that everything that Jesus says is important, but these things that Jesus teaches on the last day of his life, last days as he's sitting on the Mount of Olives with his disciples, the things that he teaches about the end of this age, the things that Jesus teaches about the coming of his eternal kingdom, those things seem extra important for us this year. So what does Jesus say about his return? Well, he promises to make all things new. He promises to wipe away every tear. He promises to raise the dead and gather us in unity with each other and with him. And man, I long for that now more than ever. I am more than ready for God to rend the heavens and come down and bring these texts of Matthew 24 and 25 to fulfillment. And I hope that these words of Jesus that we get to hear once again today are ones that prepare you now and every moment until Jesus comes for that great day. I'm indebted to my friend Jeff for the insights of this sermon and for helping me to understand this text. Often this section is referred to as the parable of the talents. I'm sorry, the parable of the sheep and the goats. But this section that Jesus is teaching isn't a parable. It comes after a couple parables, like the parable of the talents and the parable of the 10 virgins. But now Jesus makes a comparison between a shepherd and separating out sheep and goats. But other than that connection, Jesus is speaking quite clearly and directly about what will happen at the consummation of the age. It's the close of the time that we're living in now. That's when Jesus comes. And what is Jesus saying about this consummation? Well, he really gets across the understanding that he will sit as king on his throne and he will speak to those who are on his right and on his left. And to those on his right, he'll say, "Come, blessed by my Father, inherit the reign prepared for you from the founding of the world." It's a joyful word that we hear. God has done this for his people and prepared this blessing from the very beginning. But to those on his left, he'll say, go from me, you accursed, into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. It's a difficult word. And Jesus explains why both of these conclusions are true. Because of the way that they treated him. When he was hungry, thirsty, a stranger, naked, sick, and in prison, they helped him or they neglected him. And he then clearly points to the parallel: as much as you did for one of the least brothers of mine, you did for me. And often when we hear this text, what comes next is then a social ministry application. Go out and do what Jesus calls you to do. Care for the needy around you. Feed the hungry. House the homeless. Visit those in prison. And in doing so, you'll be serving Jesus. And when you do that, you'll be called righteous, and Jesus will come and welcome you into his kingdom. And make sure that you don't neglect these things so that you're not placed on his left. Now that sounds a lot like saying, if you care for others, you're a sheep. And if you don't, you're a goat. That doesn't really fit with everything else that Jesus has taught in the Gospel of Matthew. Of course, we definitely are called by Jesus in many places in this gospel and other places to care for and love our neighbors. We're to go out, provide for their basic needs of food and shelter and safety. Those are important biblical truths that we read about in other portions of Jesus' teaching. However, providing for the physical needs of the world is not the central display of Christian duty and love that Jesus is pointing to right here in this text. Loving and serving the needy in this world isn't the thing that sets you up as a sheep or as a goat. And providing for the physical needs of the world actually isn't the point that Jesus is making here. So what is Jesus's point? What is the connection between sheep and goats and Jesus' commendation or condemnation? Well, the key is that Jesus is identifying himself with brothers. And this is central to everything that Jesus has been talking about in Matthew, including he's talking about the least of these brothers of mine. And throughout the Gospels, Jesus doesn't just use this term brothers for a large group of people. He doesn't use it even for his own half brothers and sisters. But there is a group that he continually identifies with and calls his brothers. The brothers of Jesus are those whom he has sent out with the task of preaching and spreading the gospel. And this includes both pastors and laymen and laywomen who are called to bear the gospel and share it with others through this particular mission of sharing that good news. One example is how Jesus identifies with this group of people in Matthew 10. He says, "The one who receives you receives me. The one who receives a prophet in the name of a prophet, in the name of Jesus, will receive the reward of a prophet. The one who receives a righteous man in the name of a righteous man, Jesus, will receive the reward of a righteous man." When you receive a missionary, you receive Jesus. So we have this scene in Matthew chapter 25, and we can picture that Jesus wants us to know what is going to happen in that scene in the future. All people who have ever lived on earth will be gathered together, including you and me, and will be gathered as we stand before Jesus' throne and will be separated out. As he sits, the sheep will be on his right and the goats will be on his left. And there's another group that Jesus distinguishes from among the crowds, my brothers, including the least. And then it will be clear what Jesus is talking about here. He has sent out his word through messengers and missionaries that he has tasked and equipped with proclaiming this moment of his reign and even his eternal reign. And Jesus says that he himself was in the work and the proclamation of this witness of the men and women whom he used to share this gospel. Now, of course, we all serve and witness to the work of Jesus in our lives, but in this context, Jesus is specifically talking about the ones that he has sent out to bear this message in a special and intentional way. And as the workers of the gospel have gone out into the world, many of them have been hungry and thirsty and homeless and naked and sick and in prison. They have suffered for the proclamation of the gospel. So when they came with the message of good news to wherever Jesus sent them, proclaiming his death and resurrection, proclaiming forgiveness of sins and life and salvation, and they came to you, Jesus is guiding us to consider the question, what did you do? Did you receive the messenger because of the message that they brought to you of Jesus? Did you feed them then and clothe them and house them and visit them in their need because of their special task that Jesus had sent them out to serve? And did you believe in the name of Jesus that they proclaimed to you? Or did you reject them and their message, and in doing so, reject Jesus? All humanity will be divided based on how they responded to those who proclaimed the gospel of the reign of God. The messenger and the message are inseparably tied here in this message from Jesus. His word and Jesus himself are inseparably tied. And so these human voices that then have gone out and continue to go out speaking this truth faithfully are certainly Jesus' word to us. And so we then go out and care for pastors and missionaries and teachers and other gospel workers and retired church workers and their families, not because of their personality or how much we liked them or their personal giftedness as messengers. No, we care for them because of the message that they have brought to us. We care for them because they bring the word of Christ to us. And I am grateful for and indebted to so many who have been faithful messengers to me. And since you, the church, have sent me as a gospel messenger in this place, this scene from Jesus convicts me, and it should also convict many of you who have this specific and particular calling from God, or those of you who are considering this work. Ask the questions. Have I actually done what God is calling me to do? Am I remaining faithful to this truth? Is the work about me? Or is the work about Jesus? Am I willing to be hungry and thirsty and naked and sick and imprisoned for the sake of the gospel? Is this task more than a job or a profession? And does it call for the best of me, the best within me, and the willingness to set aside privilege or creature comforts and even become the least of these, be faced with these difficult life challenges if they are part of fulfilling this service to the gospel? I admit that I haven't faced anything close to what many have faced in the history of Christianity, or what many around the world today face in their service to the gospel. Real persecution, real danger, real need of the care of other brothers and sisters in Christ around them. And so we, as the people of God, we pray for those who carry the gospel among us. And we care for them in their needs so that they are not the least of these, so that they can continue on in the ministry that Jesus gives them to do. And we pray and we care for others around the world who are facing these dangerous situations, and they go about it without regard to personal cost, We as the Church of God lift them up so that they're able to continue to proclaim the reign of Jesus as King of Kings. This image of the consummation, it's also encouraging to those who go out and carry this message of salvation, because we don't go on our own authority. We go because we are sent by Jesus. And the result of this service can seem visibly small in our eyes, but the one who receives you because of your message also receives Jesus. Your work, your word of gospel ministry leads others to the right hand of Jesus. And this image in Matthew 25 isn't a parable. It's the reality of what Jesus will come and say and do for us. And this year that we're in is different in so many ways, but there is one way that it is the same as it has always been. Brothers, messengers of Jesus have been and continue to be sent out to boldly proclaim a life-changing message. And they've done this, sent by Jesus, since his resurrection, and they will continue in this work for me and for you until Jesus comes. And as they go, we then receive them and we support them in this task. And in doing so, we also receive the message that they come to bring. And that message is Jesus himself for us. We receive a message of hope from these laborers of the gospel, even the least, that these days of hunger, thirst, homelessness, nakedness, sickness, and imprisonment, those days will end. And Jesus will come in his kingdom. We desperately desire that day when Jesus will come down, when Jesus will sit on his throne, when Jesus will look at us and he'll say, "Come, blessed by my Father, inherit the reign prepared for you from the founding of the world. Come, Lord Jesus, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen."
We confess our common faith, along with all of those who are in the flock of our Savior Jesus. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible. And in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried. And the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures and ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshiped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. and I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Let's sing. Let's join our hearts in prayer. For the faithful proclamation of Christ our King, for the strengthening of God's people in this true faith and their baptismal life in Christ, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For the mission and work that God has given us to do, especially for all those who are called to proclaim the gospel around the world, who are persecuted and oppressed, who wander without home or food, who are separated from family, and yet who still preach the glorious gospel of salvation. For your flock, both strong and weak, wherever they may be, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For the unity of the Spirit, and a spirit of cooperation and harmony in our life together. For all the schools of our church body, for the seminaries where our pastors are being trained, for your service, for the campuses where our young are prepared for their occupations by their vocation as God's people, by baptism and faith. For those who have wandered from the flock of God, that there would be faithful shepherds to gather them in through the voice of God's word. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For a right reception of the true body and blood of Christ, for grace to use well what we receive here in Christ's name, and for the day when no division of doctrine or faith will hinder our communion together at the Lord's table. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For our president and our governor, for our newly elected leaders and all those in authority over us, for the hungry and the homeless and the unemployed, for deliverance from pestilence and plague, for the cleansing of our world, for those who are laboring to bring a cure to this viral epidemic and to provide a vaccine to protect your children whom you love. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For those afflicted by illness of body or mind, and for all those who care for them, especially Jeremiah and Don and Nola, Jerry and Greg and Ed, Sheila, Barbara and Eric and Carol, who are in treatment for cancer. For your continued care for Mike and Jim and Sally, for John who fell and was injured this week, for little Oliver who will have surgery on his skull very soon, for Susan who is recovering from surgery, and for Charisse and Grace and all others we know who are fighting the COVID virus. We give thanks to you that Victoria is healthy and back to school, that Kathy is released from the hospital. We pray your blessing on all those that we know who are ill, for especially Milton and Don, Carol and Keith, Mary and Christy, Judy and Branson, Charlene, Shirley, Jim and Mark. With your strength, may they all be kept through faith and delivered to everlasting life. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Father, graciously receive our prayers, deliver and preserve us, for to you alone we give all glory, honor, and worship, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. We sing together. Now, would you join me in praying the prayer that our Lord taught us? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and give you peace. Amen. Good morning, everyone. I pray that you're well. We've been offering the Lord's Supper after our worship when we have communion at the school service. We offer the Lord's Supper in the afternoon for our online worshipers. We're making a change to how we do that, and so this is just to let you know about that. Rather than having a large open block of time, we have a smaller time, but ask for people to sign up for appointments, for a 10-minute time slots for us to gather together and share the Lord's Supper. Once again, that will be done in the most sanitary way we can possibly make that happen. We'll be outside. If the weather is bitter, These doors will be propped open and we'll be just inside, but the pastor will be distant from you and masked. We will certainly make sure that we are very careful with your health as we prepare the Lord's Supper for you to share with us. Simply go to the sign-up genius that is on the your worship announcement in the email, or that is on our Facebook page connected with the morning worship service, and there you can sign up as late as Sunday morning. You can sign up for a time slot for one of those 10-minute blocks between 12:30 and 1:30 p.m. I do hope that we get the chance to share the body and blood of our Savior Jesus Christ with you. It's a precious gift, and I don't want you to miss that. May God bless your day.
I'm a stranger in a foreign land, passing through. When will I be home again? You remind me nothing here is permanent, but your words and your faithfulness.
Hi, everybody. I just wanted to give you a quick announcement about the winter gear drive. Please bring in all of your gently used or new snow gear. This year, Emmanuel Lutheran Church is also running low on children long sleeve shirts and pants. I also wanted to let you know that the winter gear drive is now extended through Monday, November 23rd because of the stay-at-home time we have been having in the upper grades. If you want to drop off your items, please drop them off in the school canopy instead of going into the school. Thank you for donating.
That's when love became the least of these. I'm a beggar on the pilgrim's road, chasing echoes of a voice I hear among the poor. I'm a stranger in a foreign land, holding memories of the love that calls the broken things to mend. When love became a refugee, he became my refuge. When love became a prisoner, he set me free. The widow and the orphan became the bride and children when he stole my heart between two thieves. That's when love became the least of these. I was hungry, I was thirsty, I was weary, you let me in. So where you're hungry, where you're thirsty, wherever you're weary, I will let you in. When love became a refugee, he became our refuge. When love became a prisoner, he set me free. The widow and the orphan became the bride of children. That's when love became the least of thee. When he stole my heart between two thieves. That's when love became the least of thee.
I need a microphone here, don't I?
I don't know what that sound is. Is that a building sound?
Pipe banging. Oh.
Rachel, would you feel better if I were to, like, stumble and fall or something so that there was an outtake here?
Sneeze in the middle.
Yeah. Good morning, everyone. I pray that you're well. We're still offering the Lord's Supper after our worship. Good morning, everyone. I pray that you're well. We're still offering the Lord's Supper after our worship. Good morning, everyone. I pray that you're well. We wanted to explain a little change that we're making to the communion that we're offering, the communion opportunity we have. Good morning, everyone. I pray that you're well. We're still offering the Lord's Supper after our worship. Good morning, everybody. I just need to make a little announcement about... No, that's stupid. Good morning, everybody. I hope that you are